Hi everyone, and welcome back to Under the Hollywood Sign, your ultimate peek behind the curtain of Hollywood magic. I'm Faliex, and I'm thrilled to co-host this show with Michel Barreau. Hi Michel.
Hi.
What's up? A big thanks to our sponsor, Music Partner, your go-to source for free soundtracks for TV and film producer. Today we've got a true master of VFX and design in the house. His impressive career spans from heart-pounding thrills to fabulous animations, each displaying his incredible talent and dedication to perfection. Prepare to be wowed by the captivating stories of his journey, from his early days in VFX to becoming a true Hollywood wizard. Let's give a warm welcome to the incredible David Banks.
Yay!
Thank you. Thank you for having me, but I don't know that I can top anything you just said, so I think we should just stop right now.
Okay. Bye-bye. See you next week.
You said it all.
No, thanks, David, to be here.
No, yeah. It's fun. I'm glad to be here. Thank you.
All right. Okay, we're delighted to have you. So my first question to you would be, and I've got many, just so you know.
That's what we're here for.
Tell us a little bit about your education, your parkour, what did you study, how come you ended up in this industry and doing what you're doing right now?
Actually, okay, so maybe you guys will appreciate this story. So if you're going to go back to my education, you know, I don't know how the system works in France, but here in the United States, when you're trying to decide where you want to go to college, often it's based on what you think you want to study and you try to find the best school, right? So I hadn't thought about any of that stuff, and I was sitting in my guidance counselor's office, and he asked me, he said, what do you think you might want to study? And so I had literally the night before seen the François Truffaut movie Day for Night, La Nuit Américaine, right? And you know, which is about filmmaking, right?
Yeah.
And it looked like they were having so much fun, right? So I said to my counselor, I said, I think I want to study film. Right?
So the night before.
I mean, I'd always loved movies, but I hadn't really thought about any of those decisions until that moment. Right. So that's sort of where it started. I was a film major in college. And then, honestly, so I had a girlfriend my senior year in college. She was also a film major. I went to school in Connecticut, and she was from New York. And at a certain point that year, that last year, she said to me, listen, do you want to spend the summer in Connecticut? You know, let's just hang out here, because New York in the summer is not so great. The film business will always be there. Why don't we just hang out here? I was like, okay. So then I had to get a job, right? And so now we're telling stories.
Like a summer job?
Yeah, except I want it to be a meaningful summer job.
Right.
So,
which is complicated.
Well, turned out, here's the story. Okay.
All right.
So I asked one of my professors if he knew anybody in the area that I could talk to. And there was a former student from the school who was working as a news tape editor at a station in New Haven, Connecticut, right? And he said, why don't you give this guy a call? So I called him up, and he said, sure, come down. And the way that that place worked was he was the only full-time tape editor. Mostly the photographers edited their own stuff, but then he would edit anything they couldn't, right? And, you know, he was responsible for the 6 o'clock and the 11 o'clock news, right? Mm-hmm. So anyway, so I go there. I watch him do his thing for the 11 o'clock show. Show goes off the air, we start chatting, and eventually he teaches me how to use the equipment, tells me he's quitting, and he's going to recommend me for his job.
Awesome.
Right? Now, so the reality of this was, I did get the job. So it was a great first job. I started working in television 2 days after I graduated from college, which is insane, right? And but the reality was, the company that owned the station was a big union-busting company. They were very anti-union. And this guy was the union shop steward. Mm-hmm. So he had been fighting with management, right, all this time, and he was leaving, and he wanted to stick them with some green kid, right?
Well, there was a plan behind it.
There was a plan. There was a plan. Right. The funny thing is, everybody got what they wanted, okay? Because he got to do that. The station got to hire me. Literally, my take-home pay when I started was $153 a week.
Right. But non-union, yeah.
No, but that was a lot. No, it was union.
It was union.
And but to me, that was a lot of money. Mm-hmm. So I was happy. I had this great job. I'm getting paid. Station got to hire me for zero scale. Mm-hmm. He got to what he wanted. Everybody was happy, right? So that's kind of where it all started. And I could go on from there, but I guess I'm trying to think where. So I stayed in television, and you're in this business long enough. There's stories. We could be here for weeks, right? So just stop me anytime. But anyway, so I stayed in television. I eventually went to go live in France, actually. I went to live in Paris. And there's stories behind that, of course.
And your French is perfect.
Merci.
We can tell.
But so what had happened was, I actually, my as I like to say, the woman who went on to become my ex-wife, she had gone to Paris ahead of me. My intention was to go there for a few weeks, have a vacation, come back to the States, find my next job, find our apartment in New York, etc., right? But we're having a good time, and she said, you know, you should visit the network news bureaus while you're here. So I went into the, I went to ABC, CBS, and NBC, because this would have been 1983, right? So there wasn't anything else. Mm-hmm. I don't think there was even CNN yet. I don't think so. Anyway, or maybe just starting. So CBS had nothing for me. I went to ABC, and there was a guy who the bureau chief and the main. Well, first of all, I've been trying to get jobs at the networks in New York and getting nowhere because I didn't know anybody.
Right.
So then I walk into the bureaus in Paris and I say, listen, I'm an American editor who speaks French. And within 2 minutes, I'm talking to the bureau chief who has hiring and firing power. So that was a huge plus, right? Anyway, so the bureau chief and main correspondent at ABC at the time was this guy named Pierre Salinger, who I don't know if you know.
Oh, yeah.
But, you know, he had been JFK's press secretary.
We know.
And if you lived in Paris, I'm sure you know Pierre Salinger because he was on French TV all the time.
Yeah.
And anyway, I'm sitting there talking to Pierre Salinger, and he says to me, listen, I don't really have anything for you, but I'm going to lunch. You want to go to lunch? So
this is French way.
but now I'm, you know, it's like I'm 23 years old, 24 years old, and I'm having lunch with Pierre Salinger. And I'm like, okay.
Let's talk about food first.
Right. Anyway, so try to keep a long story somewhat shorter. I was working mostly for NBC News, and at a certain point, the woman who ran the CBS bureau called me up. And she said, these guys are coming over to do the Tour de France, and they're looking for somebody to be a translator. Are you available?
And she was good.
And my wife was like, no, you can't do that. That's below you. She's like, you can't do that. I was like, nobody else is paying me that. You know, it's like, it's a job, right?
Yeah.
So I went and did it, and I got along really well with the people from CBS Sports, and so I eventually migrated into sports.
Right.
And so I was in sports television for 15, 20 years, right?
Oh, yeah.
And eventually came back to the States and, you know, worked as a producer and director for pretty much every major network, mostly for CBS and NBC, right? And it was great. I mean, it was great work. The production work is fun. There were fun stories to tell. You as a sound mixer, you'll understand this. So basically, the thing with sports is there's no such thing as hyperbole. You want to push all your levers to the top, right? That's how you make sports. You just do everything as extreme as possible, right? So it's a lot of fun.
Yeah.
It's a lot of fun. So that was cool. So I did that for a very long time. And the thing is, it's kind of a young man's business in a lot of ways because I was on the road 150, 200 days of the year.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, yeah.
And, you know, listen, I got paid to go places and meet people that I couldn't imagine doing any other way.
Yeah, yeah.
It was unbelievable. Yeah. It's like,
must have been fun, yeah. It's like a tour. Yeah.
No,
it's like,
and I
non-stop tour.
I've literally worked in 45 countries.
Wow. Yeah, yeah.
So, because I had this, what Americans call an international background, I was the guy that got sent. I'm shot in what was then the Soviet Union in 1985 in the middle of what Ronald Reagan called the evil empire.
Right.
And it's like, so I've seen all these things. I get paid to see these things firsthand. It was kind of amazing, right? But it wears on you after a while. It's a weird life. It's a weird life, right?
Yeah.
So I wanted to get off the road, and this is a good segue. At kind of around that time, I always remember I saw the movie Forrest Gump in the theater.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how well you guys remember the movie, but there's a scene where Gary Sinise as Lieutenant Dan is in his hotel room in New York and crawling across the floor with amputated legs, right? Yeah. And of course, Gary Sinise has legs, right? So, you know, I was looking at it and it was very well done and I was like, oh, so we don't have to film anything anymore. We can just create whatever we want,
right?
And that started to intrigue me, that kind of stuff.
So that's how you transition from live sport, live production.
Sort of, kind of, but you know.
To VFX.
It wasn't that straight a line, but.
Right.
Yeah, basically. And I mean, honestly, the real transition was I needed to get off the road. I actually wanted to get away from New York for a bunch of reasons. I came to LA. I decided that I could sell myself in the trailer business.
Mm-hmm.
Because I came from an edited storytelling background, so there's some overlap there, and I developed a little pitch, right? I had two phone numbers when I came to LA, and I made it work. So, so then eventually, I was working, my first job in the trailer business was at an agency in Burbank where our main client was Disney. Mostly Disney animateds and a lot of Disney family content, right? And I, you know, this is where I learned the trailer business, right? And then one of the things that came up was they asked us to do some promotion for this Disney animated called Treasure Planet, which was an animated version of Treasure Island, right?
Right.
And it was a good movie. Actually, which nobody really saw, unfortunately, but it was really good. And anyway, part of the Disney promotion machine was they had this show at the time on the Disney Channel called Movie Surfers, where these teenage talent that would basically promote Disney properties, right? So they asked us to create some materials for the Movie Surfers for Treasure Planet. And the thing was, the Treasure Planet had a character, I forget the character's name, it was a robot, right, that was voiced by Martin Short.
Mm-hmm.
And he's kind of like the sidekick to the main character, right? Mm-hmm. And so what they wanted to do was they wanted to create some special animation with this robot to get into the Movie Surfer stuff. And I don't know, maybe now's the time to show some of this and then we can talk about it.
Let's see, you can talk when we see it also. So let's see.
I'm gonna be on Disney Channel. I'm gonna be on Disney Channel.
This is my big chance to get on Disney Channel. I wonder if Annette is nearby.
Whoa! Can I help you?
I'm Ben, bioelectronic navigator for the new Disney movie, Treasure Planet.
Whoa!
Back you go, you naughty plug!
Oh! And you are?
Jim.
Oh, what a pleasure to meet you, Jimmy.
It's Jim.
So obviously this bit is from the feature itself. Right?
Yeah.
And then we'll go back to Martin Short in a second, then I'll jump back in.
And you are?
I want to say Larry.
Ben, right. Can you?
So that, this is stuff we produced.
Right.
Okay.
Jim, he's a little tied up.
This.
Right.
You know, he's just, he can't do it. But I'm certainly available.
You should see Marcus. I mean, he can
so,
probably help
you.
So you had complete control over the
Well, actually, well, So the way this works, of course, is so I did the creative. We would submit to the studio. Mm-hmm. They would approve the creative.
Sure.
But then once we were out there shooting, it was us, right?
Sure.
The other thing that happened was, of course, the scripts were sent to Martin Short. I was not part of those recording sessions. And it's probably great because, after all, it's Martin Short. And he ad-libbed a lot of stuff. And it was great. It was terrific, right? So then I directed the live-action portions. And then we had to create the animation for the robot.
Right.
Right. Now, that kind of animation usually takes a really long time. Mm-hmm. We didn't have that amount of time. Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm. So somebody found out that the Henson Creature Shop over on La Brea, mm-hmm. if they're still mm-hmm. there, mm-hmm. Had this relatively new system, proprietary system that they had built, where you could take action on a motion capture stage, on a mocap stage, and translate it live to fairly decent rough animation. So basically, you program the robot into the machine, right? Then you go on the mocap stage, you do your thing, and you can see right away if it's working or not.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
So, and we hired a mime to be the robot, right? Now, so this was very, very new technology. And one of the quirks of it at the time was, I don't even know if it still exists, but you couldn't stop and start for some reason.
What do you mean?
You could not stop and start. It's like once you started a session, you had to do everything,
okay.
Right? You had to do
It's a long one, right? It's a long trailer. It's like 3 minutes.
Oh, no. We are so not there yet. So, basically what that meant was, I don't know how many bits we had for Martin Short, right? But in order to give us enough stuff to work with, we had to do multiple takes of each bit, right? And we had all these bits that we had to get through, right? And because you couldn't stop and start, what they asked us to do was we created a playback tape that had, let's just say we did 4 takes of each setup. Mm-hmm. Let's just say, I don't even remember, mm-hmm. right? So let's just say we had 20 setups, 4 takes per setup. So we had to then create this tape that would play on set for the mime to try to follow, right? And it was literally 80 takes strung together with a few seconds in between. So it'd be like take A, B, C, D, A, B, C, D, nonstop, right? For hours this went on, okay? Wow. And at first the idea was that the directors of the animated feature were gonna direct the mime. That was the thinking, right? But they're not live directors. And they were like, okay, we can't do this, right? So I said, well, okay, I'll do it, right? So I'm literally like giving notes to the mime. You know, it's like a take would end. I'd say, okay, that was great. Do this next time. Back to 1, 5, 4, 3, 2, go, right? For 3-4 hours this went on, right? And we couldn't stop. And the directors were the ones actually watching the animation, and you know, I was looking to them to make sure they were happy, mm-hmm. right? So by the end of this session, I was sitting with the producer and of the feature, and he'd put this whole shoot together, I guess. Super nice guy named Roy Conley. And he tried to talk to me about the shoot and how those guys couldn't have done it, and thankfully I was there and all this stuff. I literally couldn't talk. I was so exhausted after this session, right? but that's how that animation was created, right? And so that was one moment where thankfully I had some live experience and I could use it, right?
Talk about producing under fire.
I mean, but that's, you know, that's the nature of this work. I mean, you have to be...
Yeah, you have to be involved. With the technology, and you find a new way to
and improvise.
There's always going to be improvisation. Always, absolutely. So anyway, so eventually we created all this material. Henson went back and refined the animation. We picked takes, cut it into our stuff, right? Mm-hmm. And that was it. That's how we made those spots. So it was really, that was a huge...
We can't imagine when we see it, you know, like behind it.
No, but that's the whole idea. Yeah. You're not supposed to see it. You see it, then I've failed.
Yeah, right? Of course. Yeah.
So no, you're not supposed
to see it. This is the magic of Hollywood.
I don't know. Yeah, whatever. I mean,
no, I told you.
basically, you know, you make music. Music tells a story. we're all kind of storytellers in this business,
of course,
right?
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And you know, for a story to work, you have to not give the audience reasons to think about something else.
Oh yeah,
right.
Not disturb the
right.
Yeah,
and you know, call it magic if you want to. I don't think of it that way. I just think of it as good storytelling.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? So
you're right.
Yeah. So so that was Movie Surfers, and so that was really sort of my first real experience with real VFX, right?
Yeah.
And I'd never been on a mocap stage before. I certainly knew who the Henson people were, but I was like, oh, I'm working at Henson today. You know, I thought that was cool. Right?
I bet it was, yeah.
No, it was. And, you know, it's like, the other thing is, like, when you're working with that level of professional, it's so much easier, mm-hmm. right? Because they get it, they're right there with you, they're a step ahead of you. Those people were awesome. They were great, right? So that, as I said, that was sort of the beginning of my visual effects career, right? So basically the trailer business is kind of like found art. I don't know if you know this term.
No.
So found art is like if you were to find a tire on Ventura Boulevard and turn that into something that you think is artistic and show it in a gallery, that's found art.
Okay.
Right? So a trailer is essentially found art because you're taking somebody else's work and you're reshaping it.
Yeah,
right?
Exactly. Yeah.
And there's pleasure to be had in that, but it's not the same as creating something from scratch.
Yeah.
Right? So I was sort of more attracted to that kind of stuff. But, you know, I was an employee. I was just doing my job, right? And I eventually went to another trailer agency that couldn't have been more different. So I was one trailer agency where I'm working mostly for Disney, mostly Disney family stuff, right? And, well, I won't say that part. So then,
which part?
The part I'm not going to say. So.
Oh, this one.
Yeah, that one. And then I'm working at this other agency where the main client was Lionsgate, and Lionsgate at the time was pretty much all horror all the time. This was long, long before Hunger Games, mm-hmm. right? And I'm not a huge horror fan. I never have been, right? But that's what paid the bills,
right?
Right.
Yeah.
So. At a certain point, we got a call. And so the reason I say that is because when I worked on these movies, quite often, you know, you watch them several times while you're working on it. But a lot of the horror movies, I would literally watch like this, right?
Yeah.
Because it's just, I don't find that fun. It's not fun, right? But that's me. So we got a call. They had this is, I don't remember what year this was. It would have been very early 2000s, right? And so it was really right at the beginning of the 3D explosion, the recent 3D explosion. And Lionsgate's first 3D movie was this movie called My Bloody Valentine, right? And they wanted us to create some materials for the trailer that would show what the audience experience in 3D was going to be like, how exciting it was going to be in the theater and see this stuff in 3D, right? Yeah. So,
and that was your first 3D project?
So we actually shot that one in 2D, but
yeah, it's not 3D, but it's to explain. I mean, the experience of the customer in
the
cinema.
Yeah, so that was 3D. The first time I worked on anything having to do with 3D. That's correct. And so, you know, eventually, so I have a friend who worked in commercial production, and she put me on to a visual effects supervisor, and I was chatting with him about various things. I was trying to figure out what would be the smart way to think about the creative for this job, right? And so what we ended up doing was thinking about moments in the movie that we could then sort of literally bring into the theater to help people understand what the experience was going to be like. And for instance, I don't know if you have the storyboards.
Yeah, right? I have it.
If you want to put that up. So basically, yeah. I came up with a bunch of ideas together with this visual effects supervisor. And, you know, so this is how these things were proposed to Lionsgate, right?
Yeah.
And as you can see in frame three there in the upper right, when the miner turns his head, that light literally comes out at us in 3D,
mm-hmm. okay.
pans across the audience, mm-hmm. right?
Awesome.
And then we cut back to him. He takes his axe and he throws it, and it comes flying off the screen over the heads of the audience.
Awesome.
Right? And this was really simple stuff, right? But it was really, it's the first time I'd ever done anything like this. So what we were really doing was picking up on assets and visual effects already existing in the movie, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And so, but then we had to, A, we did the creative, gets approved. B, then we did the audience shoot, right?
Yeah.
And so there's a great auditorium theater on the grounds of the VA in Westwood. They have a great theater there. And it had enough space that we could work and,
yeah,
you know,
the audience.
And there's a screen there as well. So it was kind of perfect. Because, you know, old school, there aren't that many old school movie theaters left, right?
Yeah.
And to be able to take one over for an entire day, not so easy, yeah. right? Mm-hmm. So anyway, so we went and shot this stuff. And again, this is my first exposure to a lot of these things. So
we have the movie, yeah. We can see the result.
The trailer?
Do you want to show the trailer?
Okay. Yeah.
Sure, yeah.
Exactly what did you see?
Something was following us.
Can speak it.
This is all from the future.
Most horrific event this town has ever seen. Authorities are calling this the Valentine's Day Massacre.
In the town of Harmony, something unexplainable.
Hello?
Is happening.
Come here, you better check this out.
What is it?
This January.
Run!
Prepare to witness.
What do you want?
The most frightening 3D motion picture event to tear through the screen.
There we go.
Keep going and then we'll talk about it.
Valentine 3D. Nothing says date movie like a 3D ride to hell.
Nothing says date movie like
awesome.
A 3D ride to hell. Thank you. I wrote that.
I missed this one.
Yeah. So the very last shot there, you know, where the flames come off and they go over the audience's head,
mm-hmm.
right? Now all these things have to be cleared by the MPAA before they get shown.
Mm-hmm. Oh, right? Yeah.
So, you know, one of the things I was concerned about was, okay, we look like we're about to burn people, right? Is that going to be a problem? And they're like, no.
No, cool. It was all right at the time.
That was okay. Right. Okay. So, yeah. Anyway, so then we shoot audience plates. You know, I can't remember how many extras we have, but basically you shoot them in sections, then you composite those to make the big audience, mm-hmm. right? And we shot that stuff in 2D, and eventually, because, well, I don't remember exactly why, but probably cost, and then converted from 2D to 3D in order to be integrated with the feature. Yeah. So that's the 2D version of the trailer. There was a 3D version of the trailer.
Of course,
right?
Yeah.
And, you know, so all those things.
Yeah, to be seen in
theaters, yeah, with the glasses, yeah.
I had the red and green glasses at home so I could look at stuff.
Sure.
Right. But, so that happened.
How long are you? I mean, how much time does it take to produce something like that for that trailer?
Gosh, I don't remember that one, but I do have a story about the next one, actually. So Well, what time is it?
Yeah, we can go to the next one.
Actually, it's not the next one, but so I don't remember how long that took, but you know, a lot less time than it takes to make, we had, compared to how long it takes to make a feature, we had no time.
Maybe 3 weeks, something
it was
like
a matter
that.
Of weeks. Yeah, it was a matter of three weeks, probably. Right. Okay. So anyway, so that happened. That was successful. Everybody was happy. I left that agency and of my own accord. And shortly thereafter, I get a call from my client at Lionsgate. He says to me, listen, we want to do the same thing again. We want to do it for Saw 3D, but this time we want to shoot in 3D. Mm-hmm. I was like, okay.
Right? Sure.
So this is really the first job. I had sort of decided to go out on my own, and my producing partner from My Bloody Valentine and I had just sort of come to the decision that we were going to go into business together.
Yeah.
And I think we had our name by then. We started to call ourselves Double Wide. The story is, I don't know if you guys will appreciate this. So she's from Oklahoma, right? And in Oklahoma, if you have a double wide trailer, you've made it. That is big time.
Really?
Yeah. Right. So, or parts of Oklahoma anyway. So, and we were visiting Oklahoma and there was a billboard marketing double wide trailers. And she turns to me, she goes, "That's your name." Right? And it kind of stuck ever since. And the funny thing is, to this day, we will meet people for the first time who say, "Oh, I know your company." And we know for a fact they don't. Okay? But there's something about that. Yeah, but there's something about
the name that
there's
they
something
know.
About that name that makes them feel comfortable.
It sounds familiar.
Whatever it is, right? Yeah. And so we're like, okay, great. Okay.
Something to think about when you choose a name.
No, yeah. Listen, I came up through marketing. Everything you do is marketing. Right. Everything you do is marketing, right? So, yeah, that was good marketing. Anyway, so...
Good choice.
Yeah, so we just started as Double Wide, and this job came up, and again, I'm doing the creative, and that's its own business. It's going along fine. And, but, you know, as soon as we got budget approval, then, you know, it was her job to start to plan this shoot. And she'd never shot in 3D before. I'd never shot in 3D before. Completely different equipment set, different crew set, all these jobs we didn't even know existed before we had to go do this job, right? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So she did a lot of research and nobody was really trying to help her. She figured out a way to get the right information. We ended up going to go do this thing.
Did she interview some 3D guys?
She tried. I'm not gonna tell you more than that. But she ended up doing all this stuff, right? Making all this possible. And shooting in 3D was a ton of fun. It was like right at the beginning still of the 3D wave, and at the time it was explained to us that there are all these rules about 3D, that you couldn't have things moving too quickly because that would make people nauseous, you couldn't have things coming out too fast or too far toward you because that would be also disturbing to the eye and to the brain.
Really?
There are all these rules, right?
Wow. Okay.
And you know, so, and you know this probably, I mean, production is about pushing and or breaking rules, right? But, you know, this is our first
mostly
shoot.
Mostly breaking.
Mostly breaking, that's right. I was trying to be diplomatic. But, so, you know, we were following advice as much as we could, except I played around a little bit. I don't know what we have to show here. I can't remember. Like, do you have the little piece of video I sent you of the cheese puffs? No, that's a different job. Saw.
Right, Saw. No.
Saw. Yeah, so let's look at
I have the storyboard.
Oh, I don't know. Yeah, let's look at them. I don't know. We should probably just watch the trailer.
This?
Oh, okay, good. Right. So this involved... Yeah. So I don't know if you remember the premise of the Saw movies, but people are trapped in these horrible situations the Saw movies. So we wanted to have them literally be trapped in their seats in the theaters. And I think I sent you some photos and a little piece of video of, we actually built these traps practically at first. I don't know if you want to show.
Up.
Right. So that's our prop master. He and his crew built these horrifying things, right? Yes. And then there should be a little piece of video, right?
Yeah. So I have
right.
So we can see the behind.
How many yellow suits?
And
how many yellow suits after well, that?
Well, none. Yeah.
So and we can see, look.
Yeah.
We're going to see the video now.
Yeah. So this was a test to see if we could do this practically.
That right? guy is hurt right there.
In other words, you know, could we do this in camera? This was really the test of that, right?
Right.
And basically we decided it didn't work.
Yeah.
Right? So we ended up animating those traps, and we worked with this amazing VFX house in Montreal called Hybrid, right?
Yeah.
And they're phenomenal. But maybe we should look at the trailer.
Yeah, let's go.
Yeah. Oh.
This is actually
our VFX reel.
Yeah.
This is all the shots that we did, right? So those, if you go back, can you go back?
Yeah.
All right, so just the thing on the wrist. Okay. So that actually was a practical.
Oh, okay, this one.
Yeah, you can see. Look at the metal and all that stuff. So that was real. Right?
I can see the blood also coming out of there.
There was no blood. Don't do that to me. So, but this couldn't happen fast enough, and it couldn't happen fast enough for the entire theater.
Yeah.
Plus, again, we're shooting plates of audience. So there's like several plates that are part of that big audience shot. So it became simpler to animate them. Okay. And then, of course, now we've got stuff flying off the screen.
Oh, boy.
Right? And again, we're trying to kill the audience. That's what we do. Right? This one is where I started to push the rules. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Oh, yeah?
So this is one of the characters from the movie. He reaches into the theater, grabs an audience member, and takes him into the world of Saw.
Oh, that's right? Great.
So he's trapped, right?
Yeah.
This is cool because it's a story in the story. I mean,
When we were finishing the visual effects, I went to Montreal to do the finishing, right? And the Pigman shot, when he reaches out toward the audience, you know, when I first looked at it in their screening room, I thought, okay, that's cool. I said, can we make him reach further? Because it didn't seem like super impactful. It didn't seem super scary. And, you know, the visual effects supervisor was like, yeah, sure. Right. So he reached further, right? And it was more fun. It was just more fun, right? So that was our first real 3D shoot. We learned so much, right? The depth of a shot is controlled by, you know, the difference between the right eye and the left eye. In visual effects terms, I don't know if you know this visual effects vocabulary. VFX people don't talk about 3D, they talk about stereo. It's in stereo, because there's a right eye and a left eye.
Yeah,
just like there's a right channel, left channel in stereo, right? So they call it stereo. So so there's a stereographer that you have to hire who is the person who sets up that relationship between the right eye and the left eye on set as you're shooting. Right?
As you're shooting.
Now you can manipulate it afterwards also,
right?
But you want to set a basic setting on set to work from, right? So anyway, you know, we knew none of this stuff, right? And again, this was a matter of weeks.
I have the trailer, the final one, if you want.
Yeah, let's look at the trailer, sure. This is just part of the trailer. This is just our bits, eventually.
You have watched others suffer. Now it is your turn to play.
Lots of sound effects.
Yes.
Will you survive? The last piece of the puzzle is you.
And I this effect of having something smash into the lens, right? I fell in love with this. I did it a couple times. So But it's obvious, right? It's so obvious. Yeah. So that was Saw, right? And that's where we really started to learn. And I mean, there's some business aspects to this. You know, I was fascinated by it because I'm a bit of a techno geek. But also, we were kind of the first people to do this kind of stuff. We were the first people to do this stuff for a trailer, right? And so that was kind of our thing. And I went to some length over a number of years to see if we could make that really into a business in and of itself. And there are a couple of reasons why that didn't happen. One of them was, and you touched on this before we came on, there was a lot of 3D features that were sort of rushed to the audience when they weren't really done really well. And so 3D started to have kind of a bad smell, right? Because the audience reacted badly to a bunch of things, right? And so the studios weren't as enthusiastic about promoting this thing that had some bad reactions, even though it was still, at that time, it was 40% of their box office.
Yeah.
Right? And even years later, it was still 30% of their box office, but they never wanted to mention 3D ever again after that.
I think 3D left a bad taste in a lot of people's mouth because they see it as a missed opportunity.
Well, I mean, but let's face it.
Could have been something really great.
It's kind of a gimmick, really, right? It's really a gimmick, but when done properly, it can be fun. I mean, for instance, you know, take the Avatar movies, right? So, you know, James Cameron conceived those as a 3D environment from the beginning, right? That's really how you have to do it if you're going to do it right, right? And it wasn't always done right. So that's really how that whole thing broke.
Maybe it'll come back and it would be like 5D.
No, I don't think so. So that I chased that dream for a while. It didn't really work out, which was a bummer because it would have been fun. Because I enjoyed the production. I enjoyed the creative. But then we got one more shot at the 3D world when Dimension, that was part of the Weinstein Company, they were partnered with Robert Rodriguez doing the fourth Spy Kids movie. And they were going to do that in 3D. So we got a call. So basically, they said, hey, we saw what you guys did for Saw. And we want to do the same thing, but for kids. You think you could do that?
We're like, the opposite.
Right, exactly. Right.
Why not?
So maybe we should just look at that stuff, right? Yeah. I don't. So basically.
That's great.
So here's, again, what we did was we looked at the feature. Yeah. We looked at some of their visual effects. And we tried to find visual effects that we could easily adapt to stuff coming off the screen, because that's really all you can do to promote the fact that something's in 3D. And so I don't know how much of the story I want to tell. No, just because I'm starting to get bored with myself. But I knew that the maximum number of bits that a trailer could really support that weren't from the movie itself was really three. After that, you sort of worn out, you're welcome. But they actually contracted us to shoot 5 bits, and then they wanted to make the decisions later. I'm like, okay, right? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And then we also ended up shooting a spot for Nickelodeon with the kid stars in the movie. So this became a 2-day shoot. It was a very big shoot, right?
Okay.
And what happened was early on, they had this idea that they wanted that trailer to air in front of, to run in front of Cars 3. There's always a marketing plan, and they have a target of when they want the trailer to hit. Obviously, Cars 3 was going to be hugely popular, so they wanted their trailer to be in front of Cars 3 so that a lot of people would see it, right? So, and we went down to Austin, we met with Robert Rodriguez, we're doing all this planning, and at this big meeting where everybody's there, I just told him, I said, look, and I told him all along, I said, I don't think we have time to be on Cars 3 because, you know, we're shooting all these things in 3D. 3D visual effects do not happen overnight, right? And we're shooting 5 bits, right? So they were like, okay, that's cool, whatever, we'll figure it out. Just let's go do it, right? Mm-hmm. So we go shoot, and I'm trying to figure out how to tell this part of the story. So Bob Weinstein, I get word that Bob Weinstein is coming to set, okay? So this is, you know, one of the legendary Weinstein brothers. They're legendary in a number of ways, and I won't go into that. So I'm not scared of most people, but I was a little scared about Bob coming to set, right?
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. I mean, those guys...
Head of a studio.
Yeah.
Not just the head of a studio, but those guys had a reputation, and you probably know a lot about Harvey. Yeah. Those are the stories. So I didn't know what it was going to be like, right? So, and we're shooting in the same theater at the VA in Westwood, and I'm actually doing the bit with the Spy Kids stars down at the front of the theater when I see Bob walking at the back where my partner, producer, was set up, right? They're back there for 20 minutes talking, right? I'm like, okay. So I find out later that she just charmed the pants off of him. You know, she had worked in indie film in New York 20 years before that. She was like, oh, do you know so-and-so? Yeah, I know so-and-so. So they had this long conversation about indie film in New York. Yeah. He walked down, watched what we were doing for about 45 seconds, and leaves, right? I was like, okay, great.
Green light.
Yeah, right. So the next morning, I get an email from my Dimension client, and I'm also trying to figure out how to tell this story diplomatically. He says, okay, Bob liked what he saw so much, he's now determined to be on Cars 3. So in the email, it says... No, in the email it says, tell me what it will take to be on Cars 3, which is like printing money.
Yeah, basically.
Okay. Right. So I'll leave it at that, carte blanche. So, and we're literally at that point 15 days away from when the trailer would have to be finished to be on Cars 3.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
So I called the visual effects supervisor, was here in Sherman Oaks, actually, and I told him this, and he was like completely freaking out. He was like, oh my God, what? No. I said, you're not understanding me. I said, give me a number. He goes, really? I said, yeah, give me a number. Right. And of course, we marked up the number, right? Because that's what you do. And it got approved, right?
Awesome.
So, but now we have to actually do it.
It's not open. Yeah. It's not often that something like that happens, you know.
No, it's not. You're right about that.
Yeah.
And so,
yeah, but
then we
have no time.
Then we had, and now we're 14 days away.
Yeah. Okay. Right.
So, of course, between phone calls, the visual effects producer was starting to do his real work. Yeah. And what ended up happening was we literally had artists and render farms. I don't know if you know what a render farm
is. Yeah, sure.
So a render farm is a giant bank of computers that does the computing that creates all these things, right? The rendering, right? So we had artists, rotoscope artists, designers, render farms, literally around the globe, working 24/7 in different parts of the planet, at different parts of the day, right?
A puzzle.
Well, I mean, it wasn't my puzzle to build, thankfully, right? But, you know, we had no time to do this. Yeah. No time, right? And we did it. We made Cars 3, right? And so, I don't know, let's look at the stuff.
So I have on the set, you know?
If you want to look at this. I mean, this is audience tiling. You can see how few people are here, right? That little girl in the middle with the blue shirt, that's the producer's daughter.
Oh, okay.
Oh, I'm sorry. But they're sitting in piles of painted styrofoam peanuts.
Oh, that's what that is.
That are meant to look like Cheetos, yes. Right?
Watching the movie.
And then here come the Cheetos falling down, right? Et cetera. So, and then we could probably skip ahead to the trailer.
Okay.
Right.
Let's go.
Right. This summer. Now, all of this stuff, I have to say, I hadn't looked at this in a long time. All this stuff looks so much better in 3D, and I'll tell you about that when we're done.
Oh, yeah.
But
yeah, because it was made for 3D first?
Yeah, so this is the 2D version, right?
Okay.
And then our stuff's about to start. You get the 3D. That's us. And that is clearly us.
Oh, okay.
Right. Right, and I wanted to have something flying back into the screen because we hadn't done that before, right? So,
what is that smell?
And the gag of the movie was they were going to do a version of Smell-O-Vision, so they wanted to promote that as well. So that's what that stuff is all about, right? Right, and that's us, right? But again, that's taking those gears were built for the movie. We took those and integrated it into what we were doing, right? So that was another case where the rules, we were told, especially for kids, definitely don't push the 3D, don't push motion. It's really bad for kids. It's going to be very upsetting to them. I ignored everybody.
I mean, when did MPAA come up with a chat?
No, it's not MPAA. This was the technological thinking that they were afraid that audiences were going to be physically overwhelmed by the experience. Right, and they were especially.
Who's to decide that? Who's the expert on that? Are we talking about health expert that knows about 3D?
No, visual effects people, and you know, probably there are some. They did some tests, and there was audience feedback.
Right.
Who knows exactly?
People are fainting in the theater.
Maybe. And the worry was that for kids that was worse.
Right. Of course.
Yeah. Right.
They're so more sensitive.
Exactly. That was the idea. As I said, I ignored everybody. Right. Okay. And I just said, this is not fun. Right, we have to make it more fun.
Right,
right, because we're talking about kids. Right, so we did our thing. We pushed it as far as I wanted to push it. Nobody said a thing. Nothing happened. Nothing happened. It was a total success. Right. So again, this was just another one of those instances where, you know, once you know what the rules are, you figure out creative ways to break them. And once you found out that you can break them successfully, well, you just want to do it again.
You do it again.
Right. Right. So.
Yeah, not only you do it again, but you go further the next
that's
time.
That's right. Absolutely.
That's how you push the boundaries of production.
100%.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay, cool. So.
So that was unfortunately, that was our last 3D job, right?
That was the last one?
So yeah. Like
okay.
Because, again, you know, the downturn had happened. The part of the reason Weinstein wanted to do promotion about the 3D was the fact that they were also doing this version of scratch and sniff. They had cards they were handing out to the audience, and there would be cues for the audience to scratch it, and it would release a scent that would go with whatever the story moment was on screen.
Right.
So that's really what they really wanted to promote. They didn't care so much about promoting the 3D. So we kind of did both things, right? That's what I'm saying is, from a business standpoint, the smell-o-vision part was really the reason that shoot happened, right? Not so much the 3D part.
Got it.
Right?
Got it.
So that was it. That was the end of 3D for us, unfortunately. Right?
Who knows?
We're sorry.
No.
Something else will come back.
I mean,
right now we're talking about high resolution, 8K, and all these things, HDR.
We did a job that was a private industrial job that we were never allowed to show to anybody, that was going to be shown on a 32K monitor wall that was built by a computer company only for internal use.
Really?
Right. And they wanted to shoot this very sophisticated little piece of business, right? And we did this job at a time when there are only three 8K cameras in the world.
Right.
The owner of Red gave us his personal 8K to shoot with, right?
Cool.
And so we've always done this stuff very early, right? And, you know, it's a lot of fun because A, it's a great learning opportunity. B, you know, even if there are rules, there aren't enough people who understand the rules to understand that you're breaking them.
Right.
Right. So, you know, so the work is a lot of fun, right? So that's sort of part of why I find this stuff fun, right? And the other thing is, it's like, you know, with the creative for all these promotional things, it's a total blank slate. It's just like, you know, whatever idea you can come up with that makes sense, it seems people will buy it because there's really no precedent. You're not building on something that came before. You're just doing something fresh, right? And for me, that's more fun.
Yeah, right? Of course, it's challenging and it's,
Right.
Do you have any recommendation for someone who would like to start in the VFX world and
because
production?
We don't have a lot of time.
No, we don't have a lot of time. Yeah, so, well, there's so many ways to go about it. So basically, I have done a couple straight VFX jobs in the last couple of years. We don't have time to get into them in any great detail, apparently. That's
yeah, because fine. I had a lot, like a Disney movie, Maleficent.
Maleficent. That was a main title design. Yeah. I also started getting interested in main titles for exactly the reason I just said. It's a total blank slate a lot of the time. You're not in, for instance, when you're making a trailer, you're obliged to cut a story from the movie itself. When you're creating the graphic design for a title sequence, they're really...
It's up to you and the producer.
It's up to you. Exactly. It's 100% up to you. Maleficent was interesting because this was part of our proposal. This was not the finished design, okay. But it was close. But so here's the thing where this was a sequel, right? And this was the logo from the original. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. This was the font from the original, right?
Yeah.
They were not going to change that. And so there was very little creative room,
right?
For one thing. It was really basically how we were going to treat the text, is how we're going to treat each letter. That was it. That's the leeway we had. Right.
Not for you.
No, for the designers.
Yeah.
But, and then, and one of the, and you know, all this stuff is competitively bid. So there was another house that we were bidding against, and we were bidding against the people who had done the original.
Right.
So I thought we weren't going to get the job.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But we did.
Great.
I don't really know why. To this day, I don't know why. Right. But to answer your question, if somebody wants to get into this business now and learn, honestly, the best way is to get a job at a VFX house. There's
directly.
There are very sophisticated, soup to nuts VFX houses, and we've worked with a bunch of them. The people that did the Maleficent title do Marvel movies. They do all kinds of very sophisticated stuff. The Spy Kids stuff we did at a place here in Santa Monica. I hope they're still there. But I remember when I first went to visit them, they were working on one of the Captain America movies, and they were showing me the visual effects where they turned Chris Evans first skinny.
Mm-hmm.
They could then make him muscular.
Right, right? I remember that.
So you know, there are these places. So basically, what high-end visual effects are is basically animation.
Right.
Right.
I spent half of the movie trying to understand how they did
that. Right. And as I said, you know,
I stopped watching the movie.
For me, this started with Gary Sinise with no legs.
Yeah.
So you're really talking about creating something from nothing.
Right. Right. Right.
And there are, as I said, there are any number of very high-end, very sophisticated places. If you want to learn the craft, that's the place to go because you can see the whole thing from beginning to end in one place.
Makes sense.
Right.
Makes sense.
Right.
Cool.
All right. So we're going to have to stop. Yeah, we have many more questions, yeah, but we have so little time.
I was afraid of
it. I told you.
It goes by fast.
Yeah.
Okay, so thanks a lot.
No, thank you.
Thanks
guys.
A lot. Yeah, it's very good to have you, and very interesting, and how you did it, all those things.
We learned a lot.
How did you push the?
Yeah, yeah. There's a lot of lessons that we learned today. Yeah. But thank you for that.
Okay.
Very cool.
All right, guys. Well, thank you for having me. It was fun.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Cool. Yeah. So, thanks, and see you next week or in 15 days, I think, for the show. And thank you again, David. Bye-bye, everyone.
Ciao.
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 And there is no sound.